If you do like these tank chats, do please subscribe to the Tank Museum's YouTube channel. This tank chat's going to be about the SDKFZ 142, the Sturmgeschütz III, or STUG as it's often known in the West. The idea of the STUG, it's mobile artillery. That's the idea behind it. And that idea is not a new idea. If we go back to the First World War, the British put a howitzer on what they call a gun carriage, a track vehicle based on a Mark I tank. They do that in 1917. And the idea being that when you've got an advance on the battlefield, quite often it's the artillery are needed to advance to help you continue your advance further forward. So this idea, how do you keep the artillery up with the advancing infantry? Yes, again, in the First World War, they had light mobile teams of gunners, but now with the idea of motorization, how can we do it that you might have the crew protected and so they're not as vulnerable on horseback, all the horses being vulnerable as well? So how can you have a protected way of getting artillery forward? So in the 1920s, the British come up with the Birch gun, basically an 18-pounder on the chassis of a medium B tank or Mark II tank, rather the Vickers medium. And Germany looks at the idea, again in 1927, they look at the idea of putting a howitzer on what is basically a tractor, a Hanomag tractor, to see if there's a way of having mobile artillery. But the key part in the story with the Sturmgeschütz is in 1935, General Manstein, who's chief of staff of the German army, he puts forward a paper that says we could do with some form of armoured mobile vehicle that could take an artillery piece or a howitzer forward with the infantry so that it can help them if they come across a blockage, a remaining machine gun nest or a pillbox, it can directly take on that target and therefore help the infantry in their advance. And he sees that as being very different and separate to the newly developing Panzer Force, which is all about self-contained mobility, going forward with lots of other different units with it, but all motorized to be able to go forward. So he argues in the paper, he says, technically the vehicles may be very similar, but tactically how they're going to be used is going to be very different. Now, when he puts this paper forward, it's a time in Germany where the early Panzers, the Panzer III and the Panzer IV, are just starting to, they're going through their development phase. The Germans, as we've mentioned on some of the other tank chats, on the Panzer I, Panzer II, III, those ones, what we were saying there is this idea that they are not having an easy time of it in the 1930s developing their new tanks. They've got technical issues, they've got lots of hurdles to overcome, there's financial issues as well about building these things. So when this comes forward as an idea from Manstein, the people such as Guderian or his bots, Lutz, who are in charge of the new Panzer Force, they are arguing, don't do this because it will take resources and potentially armoured vehicles away from the new Panzer arm. So they are saying they really don't like this. So there's a bit of a debate goes on in the German military, but von Fritsch, the German CNC, he sides with Manstein and he says, this is a good idea. I do think we should take this forward. So Manstein then sort of writes out a paper on how he sees these vehicles being used, and the Waffenamt comes up with a specification for what they want with this new Sturmgeschütz type vehicle. It's not actually called that at the time. So they say they want it to have a short-barreled 7.5 centimetre gun. They want it to be about the height of a standing soldier. They think it needs to be proof against 20 millimetre ammunition being fired at it. That was kind of standard as a level of armour protection at the time. And they come up with some ideas as well about how they think this might be going to be used. And they go along to Daimler-Benz, who at this stage are looking at producing the first of the Panzer IIIs. And Daimler-Benz looks after the hull and the superstructure, and Krupp comes up with the gun. That's the idea behind how they're going to put this together. Now, the problems they have is because at this stage, as I've just mentioned, Germans having problems putting tanks into production, they don't actually get five of the almost the zero series, the test series of these vehicles, these first Sturmgeschütz, until 1939. So it takes a while to actually get these through development phase and through the factory. And initially, the very first design is going to be open top for this carrying the 7.5 gun. Very quickly they realised, no, we're going to have to armour the top as well because the troops inside the gun crew would be too exposed. Now, meanwhile, as that development is going on, Manstein is setting up a force under Model that will be the actual crews for this new artillery vehicle. And the artillery is the important word to remember here, because this is artillery in support of the infantry. These are not tanks in the new Panzerwaffe, the Panzerarm. So what happens is the crews that are actually selected, they start training, they start setting up a school. In 1938, they start experimenting with tactics, again with this idea of putting on some open-topped early track chassis, where they're putting some field guns on to test out ideas about how these might be being used. And it's the artillery doing that. And the idea behind that, again, Manstein's very clear about that. He sees it as the idea of the battalions that are going to use these are going to have three different companies, each of six Sturmgeschütz. And quite often they might be actually supporting infantry in very small subsections. It might even be one, two tanks together. Very doubtful if a whole battalion is going to be fighting together at the same time. But it's artillery crewed, hence they become batteries. And if you look at that, certainly earlier in the war, the crews of these vehicles, they're all wearing the grey of the artillery, not the black of the Panzerarm, and their piping on their jackets is red, not pink, which was pink was a Panzerarm. So that's an important thing. There was a separation there. And the schools and the training and the ultimate outcome makes this Sturmgeschütz Abteilungs or battalions become a bit of an elite. They are looked at as being very well trained, very well up for the fight. They are particularly respected in other parts of the military. And as we'll see, the Sturmgeschütz story is a success. And part of that success is down to the crews that are there manning them. Now, by 39, there's only those five test vehicles. By the start of the May 1940 offensive, there's four battalions are actually ready to actually go into service. And those battalions, the vehicles, they start off with 30 millimetre armour plate. They add another 20 millimetre plates on top of that on the frontal armour. They set a crew of four, so you have a commander, you have a gunner, you have a loader in that vehicle, who also acts as a radio operator as well. On that vehicle as well, with the early 7.5 L24 gun, that short stubby gun that you also see going on to the Panzer IV, it carries about 44 rounds, and they take four types of ammunition. So you have armor piercing, even though it's a relatively low velocity gun, they come up with an armor piercing capped round. The second type of round you can carry high explosive. That's the type of round they're expecting to use the most in supporting for its blast effect, supporting infantry when they advance. They do a heat round, high explosive anti-tank, and they also carry a smoke round inside with them. And again, very quickly in those early war campaigns, the Sturmgeschütz proves its worth. And this is noticed by Hitler. And again, as we've talked already, we often think of things like the Tiger and certainly the more glamorous German tanks as having the influence of Hitler there. If you read all the developmental reports on the Sturmgeschütz, Hitler's still there on those regular conferences. He takes a great interest in this vehicle. Now, the models that go into production from Alf's A to Alf's E are based on that 7.5 centimetre short-barrelled gun. There are small changes in those development models, and they're made in relatively small numbers, 50s, a couple of hundred here and there. That idea is really that we're seeing the classic German way that they're developing the vehicle. They start with the Maybach engine, it ends up with the Maybach HL120 TRM for most of the production run. A petrol engine, about 3,000 litres of fuel. You can go to about 25 miles an hour on the road on that. But you'll see throughout the production run, developments going on. Some of that is to make the vehicle simpler. Some of that is because, again, as the war progresses, it's what materials are available. Now, Hitler in 41 is looking at the reports on the Sturmgeschütz. He is arguing to say, he says, why don't we put a long-barreled 7.5 centimetre gun? The Germans have been developing an anti-tank gun that's 7.5 centimetres, and he's arguing that that should be fixed to the Sturmgeschütz. And they start with the L-43 and then they come out with the L-48, so different lengths 7.5 centimetre gun, and that is then placed on from the F model, the Alf-F and the Alf-G, onto the Sturmgeschütz. And there's a real dividing line between them. The earlier models were the short barrel guns from the F and the G. And the Model G is the one they make the most of. From late 42, they make the Model G right up to the end of the war. So those two different lengths guns, both of them have muzzle brakes on. They are powerful anti-tank guns because when Manstein first put together the concept of the supporting artillery, he also added they could have an anti-tank role, so they can help defend the infantry should they be attacked by tanks. Now Hitler, when he sees this being developed or pushing for the idea of the 7.5mm gun, long-barreled guns with its very good anti-tank killing capability, basically the role, when that starts happening from late 42, the role of the Sturmgeschütz changes to very much an anti-tank weapon. And if you look at that, that's a theme throughout the German military. When they're fighting the numbers of Soviet tanks they've encountered, pretty much anything that has an anti-tank capability is given that now, instead of a secondary role, is given that as a primary function. You've got to be there on the battlefield to take out tanks. So the Sturmgeschütz morphs into this very good mobile tank killer. So why is it so good? If you look at a Sturmgeschütz, it's low profile. So they went for that business about the height of a man. They pretty much got there. They look at the idea as well that, again, the whole point being that one of these costs about 80,000 Reichmarks. A Panzer III, the hull it's based on, with a turret on, is about just over 100,000 Reichmarks. So you're getting a cheaper vehicle with just as powerful a gun. And what they can do there as well is, because it's low profile, it's harder to spot and to hit and easier to hide. So in that anti-tank defensive capability, it's a very, very useful bit of kit. And again, so you see, not only are the artillery using this now as an anti-tank weapon, but it's also then starting to go to other parts of the German military. Very early on, it was issued to the Waffen-SS, but then it starts equipping things like Luftwaffe ground divisions, it's going to the Panzer forces. It's being used as an anti-tank capability in a much wider way than was originally envisaged. Now, because it's then become an anti-tank gun, and we haven't got that infantry artillery support in the same way, the Germans then decide to design something called SDKFZ-142/2, which ends up becoming same vehicle, change the gun, but put a 10.5 centimetre howitzer on it. And that replaces the role of the artillery support vehicle. It's beefed up. Again, Hitler takes an interest. Over 1,000 of those, about 1,200 are made, Sturmhaubitzer. It's basically, it's a much meatier artillery piece placed exactly on the same Stug 3 chassis. So they go into service as well, so they add that role of artillery support, because most of the Sturmgeschützes are now fitted with a long-barreled 7.5 centimetre gun. In the summer of 44, they estimate there's about 1,400 of these in frontline service. The Germans are doing their calculation. They're losing about, they reckon, 13% every month of that Sturmgeschütz tank force. So they're looking, they're gearing up all the time. And again, that interest from Hitler, not only putting more powerful guns on, he insists that the new model, the Model G, has 80 millimeters of armor protection. So it's got beefier front. When the German military point out that's going to slow it down, Hitler says, not a problem, because again, in the infantry support role, you don't have to be that fast. And if you're anti-tank, speed's not going to be your biggest problem there. It's going to be this idea of the low profile. And if you look at the German production figures for armour, 43 onwards, what you're really seeing is, sometimes it's overlooked, is this is now taking greater priority than many of those more famous German tank programs, such as the Panther, the Tiger, the King Tiger, because Hitler as well, from the top, he's realizing the effects that a Sturmgeschütz can have. He's looking at the figures as well. He's got his own sort of ideas about tanks, etc. And he is seeing that that transfer from tank production to Sturmgeschütz production, we tend to always concentrate on the tanks. Actually, the Sturmgeschütz production is growing bigger and bigger. And late 44, you know, they're actually, this is the thing that's coming out of the factories more. It's the most numerous German armoured vehicle made. Over 10,000 of them are made of the standard Sturmgeschütz, another 1,000 with a 10.5 gun on. So, you know, this is the mass-produced German tank. So what are you getting with it? I've mentioned about the crewing, four guys in there. If you watch from those modifications that are going on in the F and the G, one of the things to look out for, and it's a great spotter's delight to be looking at all these different models because of the different factories, Alket and MEAG making them, you can tell the differences between the two. And you can also see during that production run, because it's such a long production one, it's not just the Ausführung, not just the model that's changing, but even within those models, as new simplifications are put by the Waffenamt saying, listen, you need to be able to do this instead of that, makes easier production. But the other thing that's going on as well is the bombing starts making an effect on the production. So, for example, in the Model G, it's got a new cupola on the top, Model G behind me here. That cupola for the commander, initially, it's actually on a ball bearing race and it's movable. When the ball bearing factory is bombed, they have to stop because they just don't have enough ball bearings. It becomes a solid cupola. Later in the G production run, they get more ball bearings again. They can make it back to being a maneuverable cupola on the top. And you'll see a number of different variations. Some Sturmgeschütz are going back to the factories to be rebuilt, sometimes battle damage, sometimes for an upgrade. So you'll see a combination of parts are going onto a vehicle. And also they're a classic one as well, first in, last out, that theory that if you have a delivery of spare parts to the factory, if they go in the storeroom, there's another delivery later, they fill up from the front. So sometimes you only get back to the earlier components at the back, right towards the end of a production run. So you find early parts going on a late model tank. So when you're looking at the pictures of all these ones, you can have that great delight in picking out, look, it looks like this factory, this thing, or it's had an upgrade, or it's missed out, or it's had field modifications as well, because there's a lot of these tanks around, as I mentioned, going through these developments. They reckon there's about 50 companies are supplying major components to put a Sturmgeschütz together. So you can see how that bombing campaign is going to be really affecting, as the German railway, really it starts hitting production from the beginning of 1945. That's when the numbers start really going down. Now, Germany actually sells the Sturmgeschütz to a number of its allied countries. Some go to Hungary, some go to Romania. 59 are actually sold to Finland, who are, of course, fighting the Red Army. And this is one of those tanks. You can tell, again, the manufacturer, September of 43 to September of 44, they add Zimmerit to the Sturmgeschützes. And MEAG has a small little square pattern. Alket has this slightly larger pattern on the Zimmerit that's put on there. They call, or people tend to call it, waffle pattern. So this is an Alket-built Sturmgeschütz sent across to Finland. The Finns had get 59 of them, first batch in 43, the second batch in 44. Most of those ones in 44 we don't think see service. But the Finns keep them in operation till the 1960s. And this one is a Finnish one. We've researched its history. It's been restored, so it's actually on the outside. It looks very much as it did in Finnish service. Modifications there, some of the modifications the Finns did over time, one of which was to add concrete on the front, either side of the gun, which gives it a thicker level of armour protection. And again, Finns put logs on the side. You could remove those logs to help make a kind of lattice road, or to help you across boggy ground. Again, if you're fighting in Finland, when the snow melts, forest tracks and rides, etc., don't want your tank sinking. And they also have the effect as well, of course, of being slightly like standoff armour. Now, standoff armour, I'm mentioning that, Schützen is added to the Sturmgeschütz is Hitler insists all German tanks have this standoff armour being added to it, and that goes on the Stug 3 as well. Initially, the fixings are pretty loose. they get ripped off all the time later on. The idea of that armor, by the way, it's not against hollow charge weapons. It's initially developed to help tumble Russian anti-tank rifle rounds that are coming in, about 13 millimeter. The idea that they do test firing, if it hits the outer armor, it will pierce it, but it more causes a round to tumble and it doesn't penetrate the normal thickness of the Panzer III or the Sturmgeschütz armor inside. So they add that extra armor. It's only later they realize that this is also going to have a good effect against hollow charge when they're being fired at. Other developments you can see on this particular tank, later in 43, they come up, one of the most vulnerable areas around the Sturmgeschütz is round its mantlet. They come up with what becomes a Sauerkraut or the pig's head type mantlet. If you look at the side of this from the side, this great big casting here ends up giving you this much better protection round where the gun enters the main part of the superstructure. So you'll notice that going on there. And they do a further development that they actually drill through the Sauerkraut mantlet and they can put an MG34 machine gun. So you'll see some later models with a little hole there for an MG34 machine gun. MG34 is carried again throughout the production run, different places. But you can see on this one, they put a shield on the top, the fins, so you can fire behind that shield. And that, again, is for really close-in support or protection of the tank and the crew from attacking infantry. So the Sturmgeschütz, very successful vehicle, given out to other allies, as I mentioned, this one, the Finnish one. And it's worth just sort of rounding up from the Sturmgeschütz because, again, we often talk about German tanks being over-engineered. Do they spend too much time on certain quality productions rather than on, as the Americans did, you know, the idea of good enough is probably going to win you the war rather than top quality all the time. This is an example where the Germans have got it right and gone the other way. They've got a very reliable chassis for the Panzer III. They simplify the idea of how we're going to get that firepower onto a low structure. It's going to be great for defensive work, which of course, really, when you think after Kursk, the Germans are defensive most of the time, and they can make large quantities of them. And again, many people looking back, look at the time and energy, the vast amounts of money that's gone on vehicles like the Tiger. Actually, would the German military have been more sensible in investing in vehicles like this, which does mean the bill of being much more simple, can be much more mass-produced in the German sense, over 10,000 being made. And for the Allies, this, certainly the Western Allies, this is a vehicle that knocks out more Allied tanks than any other type. So careful we don't, as always, get seduced by those more famous German tanks. This is the vehicle that does the business in terms of anti-tank, armoured anti-tank warfare. This is what knocks out the Allies in World War II. We are a charity here at the Tank Museum, so if you can support us, please do. Consider joining our Patreon scheme or becoming a member of the Friends. Any donations will go directly towards the Tank Museum and its activities.